And now a conservative voice who's concerned about the future of the Republican Party. His resume is long and impressive. It includes writing speeches for presidents and advising presidential campaigns.
David Frum is senior editor of The Atlantic and a former speechwriter to President George W. Bush. His book, Trumpocracy, which is excellent, by the way, and subtitled The Corruption of the American Republic, explores what he calls the undermining of U.S. institutions. And David, we're so glad to have you with us.
Thank you.
I want to start by getting your reaction to the funeral and the eulogies over the weekend for John McCain and, of course, your former boss. George W. Bush gave a very powerful eulogy. What did you take from this moment?
President Bush spoke beautifully, said to President Obama. John McCain was an authentically great man, not a perfect man, but a great man. And the country mourns him. And I was actually, just as he died, driving through from Canada into the United States through some pretty rural parts of the country. And I was impressed by how many private homes were flying their flags at half staff during the week of mourning, including car dealerships, places like that. McCain left behind intentionally a political funeral. That was his design and his family's design. They made it a political statement. It's absolutely true. The people who feel the sting of the politics are right to feel it. They're meant to feel it. And John McCain left a statement about the unity of certain forces in the society, stretching from him and President Bush to President Obama, against what they perceive as the abuse of American government under President Trump.
I'm assuming you consider it fair to say that President Trump is an authoritarian or quasi-authoritarian.
I
don't want to put words in your mouth.
Yet. What I say is he's a kleptocrat first. I don't think Donald Trump is inherently authoritarian. I think the problem is because he does so many things that if the law operated properly would put him outside the law, that he has to break the law. He's an authoritarian because he's a crook, not a crook because he's an authoritarian.
So what has he done that is authoritarian in nature? A lot of folks see a press corps that's 90% against the sitting president of the United States, roughly speaking, but I think that's a fair estimate of it.
Yeah.
They see a federal judge can step in at any point in time and say, the White House cannot do this, and the White House backs off and says, fine, we'll see you in court. In what way is this president actually authoritarian or undermining institutions beyond just tweets that I can't explain them?
Well, I think this is a bad morning to ask that question, because this is the morning after the weekend in which the president said in public that he wants his Department of Justice to choose its targets of investigation according to his political interests. You know, as is often said about Donald Trump, if he were caught by some surreptitious recording device saying the things that he says every morning on Twitter, it would be the biggest scandal in the history of the American government. I mean, just to put it in contrast, in 2013, there was a sexual harassment case in the Navy. President Obama, at a press conference, said in the most general terms that he thought sexual abuse should not be tolerated, and that for those people who do it, there should be consequences. Didn't comment on the individuals. That statement set off a firestorm, and President Obama was rebuked by the judge in the case for saying, in general terms, sexual assault should not be tolerated during the period before the guilty man they were convicted were sentenced. For the President of the United States to say on his official statement that he wants the Department of Justice not to prosecute people who are in his party, that's amazing.
But President Obama said there was nothing to the email investigation that Hillary Clinton was under for violating classified protocols, which I had a TS clearance. I can tell you, anybody else would have gone to prison.
What's that got to do with anything?
Well, that was a precedent set by a previous president of the United States. He said there was nothing to Hillary Clinton's emails. That was an open federal investigation. You're telling me that what Trump is saying or what he said about his attorney general, I mean, you were just talking about...
He was not calling for the prosecution of political opponents and the withholding action by his Department of Justice. And President Obama made his statements about the emails in the course of a political campaign when that had become the central political issue of the other side. That the rule can't be that Donald Trump gets to talk about things and no one else can.
No, but I mean, that's what I'm trying to establish. Is the rule is obviously that both presidents, or most recent president, has done this.
President Trump is dealing here with two people who have been indicted. And he says, because they belong to my party, and because the timing is bad for me, I say directly, not into the ether, my attorney general, I am commanding him, or issuing what in any other administration, and now granted, here's where I think you have a point, that if President Trump has proven to be less competent, less knowledgeable, less aware of how his government works. So a lot of his orders don't have the consequences that you might at first have feared. But that the fact that he is not using the powers of the presidency as effectively as he can to achieve his ends doesn't change what his ends are.
So he's a bad authoritarian.
He's
bad at being an authoritarian.
He's an incompetent authoritarian.
Yeah, okay. Because
he's either an evil genius or he's not.
Because he is so needy, and because he is so voluble, that he makes a lot of mistakes that are going to have negative consequences for him. So we have gotten a little bit lucky here. That's true, but the fact that the other car missed you when you were driving negligently doesn't absolve you of driving negligently. And the fact that the country has done this thing to itself, Donald Trump has not used all of his opportunities, but the opportunities are there and he tries to use them.
I've trespassed on my colleagues, so I'm sorry, Crystal, go ahead.
No worries. Is it fair to say, though, on a lot of policy objectives, you actually share some of the same ideology as President Trump in terms of questioning the sort of just...
Probably more than most Republicans.
On immigration, on trade, et cetera. So it's not so much a policy issue you have with this president, it's what he has done or is trying to do to the democracy.
Well, when Donald Trump appeared on the scene in 2015, I say this in the introduction, I've never used the phrase never Trump about myself. In his first few months, I called myself Trump curious. Not because, I mean, I knew the career of Donald Trump, not because I ever thought it was a good idea to make him president. But what I thought in the summer of 2015 was that he was saying things that were going to shake up the Republican Party in ways that needed to be shaken up. And when he said immigration has costs, we're not compensating the losers from global trade. When he began to talk about how he wanted to preserve social insurance programs, especially Medicare, this is stuff the party needs to be talking about. So what I hoped then was that Donald Trump would come into the race, make a racket, show that the Jeb Bush message wasn't working, and then somebody, maybe a Scott Walker, would steal his points and then say, okay, this guy has some insights about grievances that people have. Let's use them make a better party.
I mean, he has changed party ideology on the issues that you're talking about. Do you think that there's a chance that after Trump, the Republican Party actually moves to a place that suits you better than the previous party?
I think we're heading to a period of such political instability that it's very hard to see the world after Trump. Mm. Because what looks like we're going to happen, looks like we're going to have very bad losses for the Republican Party in 2018. We're going to have a Democratic Party that then lurches off to the left. How the Republicans respond is very hard to predict. It will depend to some degree on the magnitude of the defeat. But I think this year is shaping up to be a year a little bit like 1968, where before 1968, we knew the Democratic Party was the party of labor, the Republican Party was the party of professionals and managers, and suddenly those categories didn't matter so much anymore. And the Democratic Party became a different kind of party, and the Republican Party at the end of that process became a different kind of party.
Well, I'm going to ask about immigration. The Democrats often parry the open borders charge by saying, we don't want open borders. Look at all the people on Border Patrol. Look at all the things that are going on out there. Okay, fine. Is it fair to say that the Democratic Party now is ideologically complicit in illegal immigration? They seem, if not favorable to it or encouraging of it, absolutely fine with it, up to and including it being a central theme that Democrats keep proposing, which is that they want to do more for illegals.
Well, I think of this probably differently from the way most people do, which is I don't think that illegal and legal immigration are two separate categories. The more legal immigration you will have, the more illegal immigration you will have. And the line between the two is blurry. People start illegal, become legal. They start legal, become illegal. The question that interests me is total numbers and the skill levels of those coming in. In the 1980s, until George H.W. Bush put through Congress the big reform of 1991, one of the more underappreciated parts of the immigration story, the United States took about 500,000 legal immigrants a year, and a little more, and was getting probably another 100,000 illegal. Once you took the numbers up to 1.2 million, which is where we've been since the early 1990s, just the strain on the system, a system that is processing 1.2 million people legally each year, can't cope also with illegality. So my concern is for overall numbers. I think we need to go back to 1980s levels. And if you start doing that, the illegal problem will become easier. Here's where both parties are complicit. The border is the worst place to do immigration enforcement. The place to do it is in the workplace. You need a way for employers to check.
E-verify or something similar?
Something like that. And then you need, and this is the part Republicans never like, consequences for the employers if they hire illegal.
Big fines. Business owners aren't going to like that.
Even more than big fines, you right now it's a defense to say, I did not know. Well, if you violate other these are not criminal statutes. If you violate air and water pollution standards, if you violate any other kind of labor standard, I don't know. I didn't know that the person was a minor. You're supposed to know that the person's a minor. You should know. It's on you. And if you are employing illegal labor, you should pay a fine per incident per day, the way you do to abate any other kind of labor illegality.
David Frum, great to have you with us. Yeah, really appreciate you coming by.
Thank you.